when I kind of started working with the Chief Sister's energy, I totally understood that nothing happens when you work alone. That's the whole point. So I'm hoping just to gather people, just like we are here, just to say, okay, how can we build on this? How can we grow this? And where should we go from here? So that's my vision. So to me, the more we can work as citizens' assemblies and just... It's that everybody can take part, everybody can find their voice, and nobody stays in power, because power, we know, corrupts. So when you get people passing through and just putting in their voice, it's that I like images. So the image we've got of a system that's like a pyramid, where everything's stuck with a few at the top and the many at the bottom. But the toros, which is the system that our whole universe works on, that donut, ring donut that they say the universe is, every galaxy, every cell, the whole life working is based on this toros. So people come in and out, and it keeps moving, it keeps running. Yeah.
My father was attending the Tory Party conference. And at that time, maybe a few of you remember, the IRA were planting bombs in London, in different parts of England. But even though I was in bomb scares, even though I couldn't go to school sometimes, it never occurred to me that I could be affected by the IRA. I didn't live in fear. I know some people who did, but I definitely didn't. My world was about peace, my world was about peace and love. The moment the bomb went off, I sensed that my dad wasn't going to survive, and about 8 hours later we heard that he'd been killed. First thing I had to do was tell my little brother and sister, who were still at school, that their mother, my stepmother, was injured and that their dad was dead. Now, I had spent many years before meditating, which was not a great way to cope with emotions. It was a way to not feel, but suddenly I feel like I'm part of a conflict. I'm part of a war. I can't go back to the person that I had been. I can't go back to just believing in peace and that meditation was the answer, because at 27 I was experiencing a different reality. So 2 days later, I went somewhere in London that meant something to me, St James's Church in Piccadilly. That time it was a very alternative place. And I made a decision. I'm going to bring something positive out of this. I'm going to understand those that killed my father. I don't want an enemy. I don't want to stay a victim. So I'm going to bring some peace out of this violence. Now back in 84, there was no way of finding out how to do this. I couldn't just Google it. I didn't know anybody who'd been through this. In fact, when I started talking to people about it, they said, oh, just let go. Death doesn't exist, or something else. Wasn't very helpful. But I was completely committed, and I trusted that somehow life was going to bring me the experiences. And within a few weeks, I'm living in London and travelling back on the tube, and for some reason left early, it was midnight, found myself in King's Cross, which at that time wasn't such a safe area. I'm going, what am I going to do now? I'll get a taxi home. Well, before Uber, so I couldn't, I had to wait. And there weren't any. And there was a young man also waiting for a taxi, so I started talking to him. And we were going to similar directions, so we thought we'd share one. I could tell from his accent he was from Belfast, so I was very excited in the taxi and said, so this may seem very odd to you, but I'm trying to understand why someone would join the IRA. Do you know? My dad's just been killed. I've always been quite open. And he looked at me and said, no, that's not an odd question. My brother was in the IRA, and he was killed last year by a British soldier.
I don't know if anyone else at other levels, I mean, you know, not national as well as local, because it's not just about getting people involved, and that this would apply not just to poverty, or obviously it's not quite the right word, but bringing any minority, people from any minority group into a situation which has a previous history in it. I mean, others have experience of getting, I don't know, women into situations where women weren't, or black people into it. I don't have an answer, other than that we've tried hard and failed.
I mean, I think one of the ones where we are, the assemblies have really helped. So doing major people's assemblies, really big ones, putting them in the all the different areas in the town. There's a huge council estate in the edge of town with a community centre at the big, in the middle. So we held most of our big assemblies there. In fact, you guys, you and Annabelle were there, weren't you? And so drawing in that community there, but I think it's you pointed out one of the main problems, which is if you've got a single mum, you've got a huge amount of pressure and you're not able to afford a computer. So you guys were sorting out childcare, and you bought a computer. Yeah. So all the assemblies we've ever held, we make sure that there's a child's corner so that mums can turn up so that they can, and the kids can be looked after so they can participate. So there's lots of things that you wouldn't usually think about that you have to realise that these are very exclusive meetings unless you address those things. But it still comes down to time, man. You know, if you're really, really, like, you know, at the situation of choosing between heating and eating, you know, how are you going to go to a bloody meeting as well, man? And if you become a counsellor, that's 10, 20 hours. You know, it's just like, whoa. But we've got two who are doing that. You know, we've got a single mum at the moment, Kay Corf, who's ex-homeless. She's an ex. In fact, do you remember when she spoke? I think you were there, weren't you? She spoke in assembly, right? Yeah. So she went on to become one of our councillors, right? Yeah. So she's really struggling. She's working with homeless people across two towns. She's got two kids and a counsellor, you know, and it's really tough, but she's totally into it. So I think one of the things is to allow people to realise that this is really open to everybody, and also value them and support them, and learning how to support them is really important. But the only reason I bring it up is I know for a fact that when that happens, when people have had no agency, get agency, they just change everything. She's in there, she's just having a massive go at them today.
So we're letting this happen.
Yeah.
But my point is also that means that if a bunch of people turn up and go, oh, I'd like to stand, please, you can stand and get elected, you know, and then you can do stuff, actually. We can do stuff. So we are letting this happen too. I mean, we are complicit to some extent. I mean, it's the sad news. Alison.
I mean, to me, it's about looking at young people, getting young people engaged, especially as teenagers, in discussing, in seeing they can bring about change, in enjoying political process, in participating. And to me, that's the only way we're really going to turn things around. That would be my approach. And I've just heard, for example, about a wonderful kind of proto-parliament that was run at the Shambhala Festival last week. I don't know if anybody here was there, but some people from Frome were involved in running it. And the fun they had, where the speaker turned into the listener and people became MPs with paddleboards, MPs for silly things, and then they had to swap them around and be MPs for different stuff. There's incredible potential for getting young people involved. And then you have to involve the schools so that you can, or the council, so that they can actually see that the decisions that they make lead to a result. So, to me, that's the only place to start, because school can be a leveller.
It says it best than I
think your thing about the youth is definitely interesting and right. And again, it's an area we failed in Frome. We introduced having a young person's mayor and deputy mayor, and they became old. They became even older than me. I thought, wait, we're going to have, you know, they'll do their presentations in rap and, you know, Rafita shows out what I think, you know. They came to all the meetings, far more than most councillors, and they were great and really, but it kind of really didn't work. And I know that that's been other people's experiences of trying, you know, bring, it's like, you've got to change the system. It's the system that's wrong, not the individuals. And so bringing young people into the system just draws them into, well, it didn't work for it didn't work for us. So as Frome, we tried to do other activities out in the community, but again, we sort of, found that didn't work. But I like what, doing things like what Alison was talking about sounds great.
We gotta take the power back, yeah. We claim our heart's deepest fire. We'll take your sword and hold it out proud. And keep your mind as clear as the night. It's time to look ourselves in the eye. We gotta face ourselves in the light. We gotta hold ourselves proud like lions. We gotta roar our animal pride. Yeah, we gotta stand strong and stand firm and come together. Come together, yeah, we gotta take the power back, yeah. We claim mother we are, yeah. Can I hear you? Take the power back. We gotta take the power back. We claim mother we are. We gotta take the power back, yeah. Feel it in your heart now, yeah. Gotta take the power back. Feel it, feel it inside.
On copper, mainly skyscapes. So that's burned there. Can't see it now. Actually, neither this light.
Yeah, they're moving.
Yeah, and they're trying to get back over there.
Right, we're going to have to escort them away.
Hi, I'm Julie Oldfield, and I'm going to be doing a session here with a bonfire and talking about my art. And I work on copper, bits of copper, bits of aluminium, bits of stainless steel, and also brass. I use fire, as you can see, I burn them. I use patination techniques such as acids and alkalines. So you can see a website. Maybe does it sometimes. So this is for my metal mark.
Selected city councils. So what I'm going to get you to do is to deliberate the pros and cons of replacing the House of Lords with a permanent citizens assembly, a House of Commoners, if you will. So the first discussion is just going to be the pros, the benefits of replacing a House of Lords with a permanent citizens assembly. So, talk amongst yourselves. The facilitator will control and make sure no one dominates the conversation, that everyone gets to have their say. And once you have come up with a list of pros, which your secretary will have taken down, we will then have brief report backs from each group.
Really, the journey was about, I want to know my land and our people. And I want to revel in the fact. And I was 60 at that time, I'm 70 now. But I thought, well, you know, I never want to stop having adventures. I always want to lean into these experiences. And in the same way that when I go and visit Vodafone, I'm not that many people that would find out what the Internet of Things team are finding out, or when I go and speak to the police and lecture on leadership to them. You know, I love it because I get to learn a little from a different perspective and value a little bit more this exquisite, tender, extraordinary life that we have. I hope that we as a people make the choice now, again and again and again, to be the bravest part of ourselves and commit ourselves to something really exciting in these coming weeks, months and years. Thanks very much.
Thank
Thank you.
Everything's gonna be alright. ocean. And we sing around the fire for a resolution.
Into an apple, you're used to that. You don't get around the garden going, oh my god, there's an apple, oh my god, I just can't face it, I need therapy. Or maybe you do. I slightly can't afford to do that with like, nettles on my land.
That's a really good one.
Thank you.
When I was 21, I stopped growing. So I basically done 32 seasons, right? I've grown food for 32 seasons. About 8 weeks ago, I decided that I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm just going to be doing Extinction Rebellion. So I've talked to my mates on my farm. If you don't know, I'm an organic farmer. And I talked to them this weekend, and they're buying it off me. So that's it. For the first time in 32 years, I'm going to have no land, right? That's it. And this, for me, is like one of those big steps, you know? I'm sure some of you may have made a similar step, or you're probably going to make a step. And it's scary because you're going into this unknown. One of the reasons why I've done it is because I've got this drive in me. And I know this sounds potentially a bit dodgy, but I do feel a little bit like one of those guys in the Old Testament, right? I don't know if you've read that. I can't quite remember the stories. I was brought up as a Christian, so I can half remember it. It goes something like this. There's some guy and he's tending his sheep, right? And God speaks to him and goes, you're not going to be tending sheep anymore. You're going to go out and speak righteousness or something to the sort of corrupt and fallen masses. You know how this language goes. So, like, I don't know whether that's... I'm not bothered whether God exists or not, but it's certainly true. I wake up in the morning with this massive drive, and it's a schizophrenic sort of thing, because most of me just wants to have a quiet life, but there's this like voice inside of me going, fuck this, you know, you've got to get out and do what you've got to do. So that's the sort of that's one of the reasons I'm here.
I know there's lots of you around this space who spent 30-40 years trying to create a semi-decent world. I have two, and it's not going very well, and I don't quite know how the fuck we're going to sort it out, okay? So I'm going to give you some ideas about what Extinction Rebellion's doing and what I think, and then afterwards, hopefully you'll be relieved to know we're not going to have a Q&A, right? Because as I've been trying to say to people around the country, the days of Q&As are over. Where we're at is we're in this total fucking crisis, right? And if we don't start to emotionally connect with that, then we're going nowhere, basically. That's one of my central messages. And I'm saying that as a pretty shy, repressed, you know, mum was a Methodist local preacher, don't ever show your emotions sort of guy. But I can't like give you a nice happy clappy talk, right? Because it's beyond bad. So I'm gonna try and sort of put forward a few incoherent ideas, and then at the end, we can have people stand up and say what their truth is and what their coherence is, and you can help me by becoming more coherent than I am. And what Extinction Rebellion did was it got together these heretics. And the biggest reason we were heretics is we came to the conclusion we'd have to tell people the truth, even though it's going to upset people, right? So when we were in this cafe in April last year, when we founded Extinction Rebellion, what we decided to do was to tell people the truth and act as if it's real, which is even more difficult, right? So obviously, like, the whole climate change industry, in so much as they knew about us, thought that this was a completely fucked strategy, right? Because as we all know, if you upset people, then you put people off and they won't be motivated and they'll just get upset and depressed and won't do anything. Okay, so as it happens, that's bollocks, okay? The truth of the matter is most people get depressed and don't do anything, but some people do. And the some people that do get extra motivated are in this room today, right? The people that are getting depressed are still out there, right? In Frome or in Somerset or whatever. They're still going, I don't want to look at this because it's easier not to look at it. But a critical mass of people have decided that they do want to look at it. In fact, 100,000 people have decided they do want to look at it, which has made Extinction Rebellion the fastest growing, biggest climate change movement in this country, right? That's where we're at. One of my requests of you is if you feel you've got that voice inside you, you've got to do it, right? Because one of the things we've failed to do for 30 years is to have people stand up and get emotional in front of other people. And this is the way we're actually going to make this thing work. So what I really want to talk about is what it means to be human. And when you think about life with that intensity, you start coming up with these fundamental ideas, which is, do you want to end your life or not? And if you don't want to end your life, then you have a responsibility to be truthful to what it means to exist. This is mid-20th century existentialism, right? I read about it in my 20s. It's been my main influence. Everyone else in our culture, you know, no one talks about this stuff. But it's coming back, I can tell you. It's coming back. The death bits have been taken out. Well, why is that? Because lots of middle-class people have come into Extinction Rebellion. I'm middle-class, okay? So I'm not giving anyone a hard time. But everyone knows what I'm saying here, right? They say, well, Roger, we don't need to talk about that, right? We just need to, you know, tell people there's a problem and sign up at the end, right? I mean, that's what Friends of the Earth has been doing for 30 years, right? Give the £3 a month and we'll sort out climate change for you. It's completely fucked, right? That's why nothing's happened for 30 years. It's because people haven't got a grip on what it means to be human and what it means to think about death. So my sort of like, what I'm trying to grapple with here is this notion, and I said this in my original talk, is everyone wants to escape death, but there's a whole tradition that says, once you've actually gone into it and come out the other side, then you're a new person because you can accept it. And my proposition is nothing's going to be happening on this whole climate change crap until people have made that transition. Gone to the other side, where you're going to say, I don't actually care. I don't care what happens to me anymore because I'm over this and now I'm happy to go to prison, which is why I'm not really talking about prison, right? Prison is just the end part of the process. The real process is actually thinking about what it is to be you and what you're going to be doing when you're on your deathbed. You're thinking about two things on your deathbed. You're thinking about your relationships and whether they were any good or not. And you're thinking about whether you made a difference. But it's like now I'm experiencing real history. And my proposition to you guys is you're on the cusp of experiencing real history, right? Real history, of course, is a euphemism, right? It's a euphemism for death, okay? That's what history is about. You know, terrible things happen to people and they come through it and they don't come through it, right? So all in a few years' time, all those nice people in Frome and all those nice people that don't come to these talks, they're going to get thrust into it as well. And it's not going to be voluntary. It's obvious what needs to happen. We need to rebel. And when I say rebel, I don't mean a fucking brand, right? It's not Hey, Extinction Rebellion, all I'm talking about here is a rebellion, right? Look it up on Wikipedia. A rebellion means you go out, you break the law, you go to prison, you get let out, you break the law, you go to prison, you get let out. Because nothing else is important. One thing I want to finish on is the people that are going to get arrested and the people that are going to go to prison. We're the lucky ones, right? That's my proposition to you. Because we've half made that transition. Because when you've got nothing left to lose, you're free. When you've given up your farm, given up the career, when you've talked to your family and they've disowned you, you're finally free to be what you have to be. And I don't quite understand it, right? And I'm not saying like it just goes flip one day, right? I'm feeling pretty free today because I've given up my farm. But I know in about a week, I'm going to be having the heebie-jeebies again. So it's not like, it's not a smooth process. But there's a process here, right? And hopefully some of you know what I'm talking about, which is you give things up. And it's central to the experience of life, right? I think what climate change is it's a sort of metaphor for what's going to happen in our life anyway, right? It's just like coming a little bit fast down the tracks. It's the same sort of thing that happens when you go to the doctor and you get that diagnosis, right? It's the same thing. Anyway, so I've just been on holiday with my kids, right? I'm not a very good dad because I think too much. Right? I'm an intellectual. All I do is think. That's why I'm in this movement doing the strategy stuff, right? Because I'm good at it. But if you're good at some things, you're bad at other things, right? I'm not actually very good at being a dad. But I've just been on holiday with my kids. Yep, I'm separated from a wife. Yep, it's over climate change, right? And what I want to say last of all is at the end of the day, that's what we're doing it for, right? I'm trying to do it for my kids and I'm trying to do it for all the kids. And I want to read you something with my glasses. It's a song by Bob Dylan. Lord, protect my child. For his age, he's wise. He's got his mother's eyes. There's gladness in his heart. He's young and he's wild. My only prayer is, if I can't be there, Lord, protect my child. As his youth now unfolds, he is centuries old. Just to see him at play makes me smile. No matter what happens to me, no matter what my destiny, Lord, protect my child. While the world is asleep, you can see it and weep. Few things you find are worthwhile. And though I don't ask for much, no material things to touch, Lord, protect my child. He's young and on fire, full of hope and desire. In a world that's been raped and defiled. If I fall along the way and can't see another day, Lord, protect my child. There'll be a time, I hear tell, when all will be well, when God and man will be reconciled. But until men lose their chains and righteousness reigns, Lord, protect my child. Thank you.
Because it's one of the first times I've heard somebody speak the truth, which is the truth about my family. My family are German and English. My family were the German soldiers. My uncles were the ones in Russia. My family were the ones who were also bombed out. They were the refugees. They were the army, they were the soldiers, and I'm also English. So I've had to face that thing about war, and I've been pissed off all through my childhood, having my English friends say, why didn't the Germans do anything? Why didn't the Germans do this? How could they be like that? That was my, and they're talking about my family, and nobody was ever saying, hang on guys, you have to face stuff. So I'm seriously looking at going to prison in October, being arrested in October. And I want to say something about feelings. Feelings. I have to cry and shake and feel, because if I don't, I can't keep listening. I can't stay there. And I'm willing to be embarrassed and to show myself up and to show fear. Because I am scared. But I'll tell you one thing. Have a look at each other's faces. Look at each other. We're shitting ourselves. It isn't a bad thing. But there's something about how we work. Fight, flight, freeze. The basics inside us. And we have to do something about it. The good news is we can. Because if you're going to have to shake, do face whatever it is to face the feelings of this crisis. We're going to have to connect with each other. We're going to have to listen to each other. We're going to have to give each other space so we can face the feelings and do the actions. So thank you, Roger, for that this chance. And I'm going to be doing loads more crying so that I can do the actions.
My name is Jackie Walker and I did a talk earlier, and my talk was about the more dangerous it is, the more important it is we tell the truth. And some of you may know what that has meant to me and the threats to my life that I've gone through to do that. And I don't see my struggle for telling the truth as any different to the Extinction Rebellion. I think it's the same struggle. And it's the same forces which are attempting to silence us. And I think some of us have a privilege at the moment. We are at the time of our lives, whether that's because of age or because we have a certain measure of independence or the age our children are, or whatever it is, or we have a certain particular shall we say, sense that we have done what we need to do and the extras are there for us now to do. And I certainly am happy to join in with that commitment to be prepared to go to prison. Because I have to tell you, there is worse than going to prison, and there is worse than individual death. And that's why it's important.
Today, I always thought I was quite brave, and it turns out that maybe I'm not as brave as I thought I was. I have two grandchildren. One lives in Wales, and the other one lives in Melbourne. I sat on the bridge, Waterloo Bridge, with my family and my grandchild from Wales, and we played in the sunshine, and it was quite amazing, and we sang songs to the police. And I felt very happy with myself, although it was in the face of something just, well, apocalyptic. My grandchild from Melbourne and their family recently spent 7 weeks with me, having flown over here because I can't swim that far. I really want to be able to go to prison. At the moment, I can't bear the thought of not being given a visa to go and see them. But it's a short-term thing, isn't it? It might be that I don't get a visa now, and then the whole of bloody Australia's on fire in 2 years' time. So I've got to find some lady balls from somewhere. And sign that piece of paper, and I also need a really big drink of something very strong.
And they got into it, so you know. So when I point this wand at you, I'm going to say, I cast you out, and you're going to say, we cast you out, okay? So we're doing kind of a magical spell. So when I go, I cast you out, you shout,
we cast you out.
Yeah, that's kind of, let's do it with a bit more like, yeah, passion. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Awesome, okay. And the one other bit that you need to know is there's a line where I say, I don't believe in you, and you say, we don't believe in you, okay? So, I don't believe in you.
We don't believe in you.
Excellent. Okay, we're going to try this?
Yes.
This is called I Cast You Out. I don't know what else to say about this, but it is a spell against some of the more narcissistic characters of our time, and it is a suggestion that perhaps be more wonderful to talk about the amazing heroic characters in this time. So, Boris, yeah, I can't hear you. No, I'm not listening anymore. I don't care what horrors or wonders are in store. I'm sitting on the floor with my back against the door. Some garden centre leaflets, pizza vouchers in my lap. It's all more interesting than you. That tiny money spider making its eight-legged scuttle across the battered leather of my shoe is more awe-inspiring and less urge-inducing than anything you can ever do. You are a snake charmer in Eton armour. Your mop top hair is meh. There are 100,000 million better blondes out there. Your USP would wilt in the wind next to the lion's mane magnificence of German sea captain Pia Klemp, saving refugees from Libya's coast. She is sexy like Mad Max. You are flaccid like raising the threshold of the wealthy's income tax. I don't want you in my feeds. My verges are wildflowers. You are mown down weeds. Less forest, more trees. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
With every bit of my indifference to your charm. I cast you out with a middle finger of my right arm. I cast you out like a plucky underling doffing a sarcastic cap to a foppish squire. I cast you out like the constituents of Brecon and Radnonshire. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Like this carbon neutral scheme to bring efficient cookers to Uganda. I cast you out like this recycling bin full of soggy Brexit propaganda. I cast you out with all the inconsistencies and forest buses you cannot hide. I cast you out with the humanity you have fracked out of this nation's pride. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
With this kipper, don't let it slap you on the back. Cher Bolsonaro, you are the stupidest man to ever try to breathe. Burning down the Amazon is the Darwin Award's greatest overachieve. You might try to kill our air, drive the natural world into a zoo, but I tell you, Mr. Impotent Firestarter, snowflakes can put out infernos too. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
With this burning ember in your money, I cast you out with the screams of 1,000 tigers, 1,000,000 monkeys, 10 million trees. Let them haunt your eyes and howl like ghost trains through your dreams. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Farage, eye of newt, face of frog, milk of shake. You are senseless static. My interest has peaked in its demise. You are lager soaked in lies. I turn around in slow motion and sip my banana smoothie without peeking. Your mouth is moving, but I can't hear you speaking. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Into the Atlantic Ocean without a raft or EU sanction regulations or any help from the United Nations. I cast you out to a time when Royal Britannia ruled the waves and most normal blokes were right-wing slaves who died in gutters of pox pustule plague. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Hopkins, Leadsom, Mogg, Morgan, Cummings, Brewer. The nothing from the never-ending stories is raging through your Twitter sewers. No one's looking, no one cares, no one knows what you were for. I don't believe in you.
We don't believe in you.
Delete, ignore. Aaron Banks, I cast you out with Greta Thunberg's courage, a force so potent it lures the demon to your eyes. Old white men who take pot shots at heroic teenagers should be properly exorcised. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
Trump, last on the list, not to be forgotten, barely to be missed. You are Hitler's stagnant bile. I cast you out with the twinkle in Michelle Obama's smile. I cast you out with the song of a lark in trembling flight. A plague on your golden tower, a blast on your mirrored sight. Remember, fake tan does not show up in the nuclear winter night. I cast you out with all the power that's inside of me. With every mountain, every tree, every witch hunt that rode the spine of my ancestry. I cast you out with every acorn, every veg box, every bee. With every broken heart of every refugee, I cast you out with everybody who is fighting for this planet and humanity. With the hex of this X in this box, on this ballot, with this pencil, with it on this tiny piece of string, I cast you out with this poem, with this mantra, with this moment that you can sing. I cast you out.
We cast you out.
I cast you out.
We cast you out.
I cast you out.
We cast you out.
May your teeth splinter with every lie. His blood on your hands, his love for your heart, his salt in your eye. Oh.
I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching out to freedom land. I'm gonna keep on walking, keep on talking, marching out to freedom land. I'm gonna keep on walking. Keep on talking, marching out to
freedom. Thank you.
maybe take a deep breath in and see what comes as you breathe out.
You're from that religious group, I'm from this one. So it's easy to let you go. When there are 500,000 refugees, not the handful that were picked up yesterday, on the Kent coast, but 500,000 refugees trying to get to this island because they need a share of the food and water that's here. When that's happening because of climate change, as is quite likely to be within the next few years of our lives, how are we going to deal with that? Either we let them in and say, of course, welcome all strangers, or we say, no, you stay out. And the only way, because we are fundamentally, I think, such good and kind and connected people, the only way we can do that is by making them other. And we've had a whole inheritance of that, especially in Britain, you know, the racism, the imperialism. We know these people are other. The darker they are, the easier it is. They come from North Africa, they're Muslims, whatever it is, whatever excuse we'll find, we can other them and say they're people who it's, we can slightly dehumanize them, and therefore we can turn a blind eye when the army is sent to keep them out. And then when the army starts shooting them, we can turn a blind eye. And then what happens is those people organize and start to shoot back. And then we get into a war or a civil war. And then we go down and we don't deal with the climate crisis and we all die. That's what will happen if we go along that path. If we go along the path of fascism and say, okay, we're gonna shut all our borders and this country, we're gonna now decide, and all the Brumainers and the Moners and the progressive types and those people, we're gonna clamp down now, we're gonna get it back to some kind of controlled, orderly situation and look after ourselves, which is the trend at the moment. If we do that, we won't unite to act on climate change and we'll all die. If we start to struggle between countries, if we start to get too involved in, well, who was right and who was wrong with this, and should they be going through there, and isn't that oil needed more by us than by them and all the rest of it, we'll get nuclear exchanges. And if we get nuclear exchanges in the next decade, we'll all die. What I'm saying to you is, unless we actually find a way that does spread kindness and compassion, we are doomed. It's no longer like kindness is a nice thing. Wouldn't it be nice? Why don't we? Oh, if only we could. You know, this is one of the things I notice about our society. It's very clever over history. Is that we've made this very basic thing that we all do into something really elevated on the one hand and inspiring and beautiful. And on the other hand, something which is so soft and spineless that none of us believe it could ever actually run the world. We believe that reality, well, that's nice. And then the reality is this. So what I'm wanting to do, really, myself, is find a way to bring that understanding to the fore and to find a way to give kindness and compassion some spine, to arm it, really, to mean that it is no longer seen as the weak option, but that we recognise it is essential, therefore how are we going to spread that? And if we've been touched by Extinction Rebellion and those ideas, and I know you had the talk here from Roger Hallam, which I personally, when I heard it, it changed my life because it brought together what I already knew in that way that sometimes can happen. It crystallised it, which is that we really are up against it. This is an existential crisis that we're in, and therefore we need to think outside of any box we've already got. We have to have such radical action so quickly that we've got to find a way to step up. And what's happened there, of course, is we've stepped up political action. So interesting to see when I came back yesterday from camping in France that now, after the XR stopping London, now we're seeing people, again, a revitalisation, really, as tactics have been used before, but people say, OK, we're going to stop Parliament. Well, not Parliament, we're going to stop London until Parliament is, you know, until this ridiculous coup is stopped. People are willing to think about stepping out like that, and we have to do that, but that's a very dangerous time. We're in a dangerous time. Wherever we go, it's dangerous. If we pretend it's not happening, it's dangerous, because we need everyone to be part of this. All these people are up against it, and we are, although we have this slight privilege of some time and some slack still. And I think we need to use that now to explore how to put kindness at the centre of what we're doing. And I've said that I think there are policies, I'm not going to go into them because we could disagree about the details. We've recognised, I think, in general, that people would need to get together and talk. But the issue is, why is that so hard? And I know, as someone who's been involved in Green Party politics and in other things. I know in a lot of the direct action struggles, I know how quickly, and you can find this out for yourself by simply going onto Facebook and watching, making any comment about anything that's happening in the world and seeing how quickly it is before that degenerates into somebody, into an us and them, between you and someone else, or between some other people and them. And how quickly it moves away from any respectable listening. You know, we're finding it really hard to be kind to each other. And that's because we're under stress. It's also because of the nature of social media. It's also because we're being manipulated. It's also because, as we found out, that whole thing of negative and positive news has been exploited by social media, because it engages us, it keeps us on social media more. And once that was discovered and they monetized social media, then boom, we're into this mess where actually that's now, the algorithms are selecting for our distress. You know, the algorithms are selecting for things which will stimulate us and make us angry or make us ecstatic or whatever. They're stimulating us all the time. And that whole system, we're engaged in it, and obviously we're struggling with it. And I'm sure that given time, we'll find a way, eventually we'll pull that in and we'll have a way to deal with it and control it. But we don't have it right now. So what I've been training myself to do and challenging myself to do is never to assume, even on the positions that I'm sure I'm right about, is when somebody says, it's to keep checking that, keep checking it. Never assume, you know, and not be afraid to do that. And maybe that's the key thing that we all have to work on, is why are we afraid of that? And I think there's all sorts of things we can do to work on that, and you find your own way through. I'm afraid when a woman challenges me about my sexism. There's a bit of me that really doesn't want to admit that I still could have it. This isn't about following righteous feelings anymore. This is about how do we get out of this minefield by creating cooperation between us. We have there's no luxury of being self-righteous as you go down with the ship, because everyone will go down. I've got to find a way to connect with the maximum number of people and to create some kind of culture politically and socially where we can all say, okay, I trust you, you trust me, we'll get through this. So that when that real emergency is hitting us, that's hitting other people in other parts of the world, when it really is, there's people coming, I don't know if we've got enough food, we can actually try and figure out a rational way to deal with that situation. And what I think is the revolutionary thing about the kindness that I'm talking about, and I had to do all this preamble, but what I think is revolutionary about it, and it has been ever since it was first stated many thousands of years ago, people have realised it, is that I treat that person with kindness, however unkind they are. And I think this is the challenge. That sounds like a spiritual or a Christian thing in our culture. It actually is the challenge, and I think it's actually the winning tactic, and I'll tell you why I think it's the winning tactic with all people, and I've been experimenting with it on social media and stuff, is that when someone comes back at me with something, I'm going back to them, I'm giving them a bit of space, I'm thinking, okay, you just made a really racist attack on me, or comment, I'm going to tell you that I didn't like it, but I'm not going to other you, I'm not going to say, you fuckwit, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to find something about you that I recognise as human. I'm even going to compliment you on that. And I'm going to tell you what I don't find acceptable. And that it is never acceptable. And if you see me acting in a human way towards you, it makes it easier for you. So what I thought was, we've got basically sociopaths in control of the planet. A very small number of people. And then a whole load of people who are feeling very distressed and confused and hurt, and whose instinct is to make sure they look after their own, however big they're able to make that net of identity that they're, you know. But even if we manage to make it like all the people who are subject to these sociopaths who are destroying the planet, that's not quite fair. We have to be honest about it. We're all destroying the planet, but we're part of that system. Even if we're really ready to change that system, how would we get them to give up their power? How would we overcome them? And I think that everything I said is kind of, that's going to be the basis then of how we strategize. But it's about being realistic, it's not about being soft. People are afraid of the anger that's coming at them. So I think you don't. It's not about anger. When I'm dealing with the police on the front line, I've had a lot of experience with police in different front lines. I've been very lucky because I've been in this country and I haven't been shot at. I've only had guns pointed at me in Palestine. But even there, and I was in a privileged position because I wasn't a Palestinian, and therefore I wasn't being treated by the IDF quite the same way. So I did have some, it made it safer for me. But I used that safety, which is what I think privileged people should do. And we're all privileged in this room, on this planet now. Used my privileged safety to take a bit more of a step and push more at the line. And to say, look, I know that you're a human being. And to make them laugh about it even. Say, we're just the same. Find those points of commonality. Refuse, however angry, the person is, refuse to engage in that. Sooner or later, you know, those forces that are against you, I believe we may crack them if we have genuine non-violence. By which I mean a firm attitude of holding a line, but a clear attitude of, I don't hate you. It's not thinking that you're any better. And I think that's the other key thing that I'd like to say, which I think is the work that we all have to do, is that I am no better than anybody else, and I quite often I'm reminding myself of that. In random places, at checkouts, while driving after someone else has just cut me off at a roundabout, you know. I notice that I do that too, that I am literally no better than anybody else. And I keep exploring that and making myself examine. But let's try and create this culture where we recognise, and I don't know how we quite, this is your question, I don't quite know how we bring this into the focus of what the words are, because the words have been devalued, love, compassion, kindness. When I say devalued, they've been turned into this special thing over here, which is so lovely, but so unrealistic. And what I'm saying to you is, there is no other way out of this situation. Kindness to all species and all people has to be compulsory, because if it isn't, we will fight and we'll die. Thank you for listening. I hope it's given you some stuff to think about, and I hope that some of you will come and tell me what you think afterwards. Thank you.
Go into groups of maybe we've got time about four, preferably not with your partners or people you came with, and just talk about how you relate to this, and if there's one, because we all have all of those, and some of them we are stronger on, some we're not, some we need to ask help to help, you know, to bring in the help we need, others we're actually are our strong dominant ones. I mean, any of us, I am quite sure, could relate to any one of these. Is there anybody that can't relate to any of these? But they will be in different levels of resonance for you. So, shall we do that? Just give you about, I don't know, 10 minutes. I'll keep an eye, I'll walk around the room and make sure that everybody gets a chance. When somebody's speaking, I'm sure you all know this, it's about listening, hearing, being aware, so let them speak, but don't anybody monopolize either. So, every one of you in the group of four has an opportunity to really share what you feel about these, who you most resonate with, and where you think you might need some help. I'm going to be doing like a 48-hour workshop in the next 10 minutes, if that's all right.
Okay. And so I'm going to make the sound ah, because that's a sound that reverberates, especially from the heart chakra. So don't worry, sound healing is for internal. It doesn't matter how you sound, doesn't matter whether you're in tune, whether you think you can sing or not. Doesn't matter, just make a sound, open your mouth wide and let it come out, and close your eyes so you can really feel the sound vibrating internally if you would like.
Thank you.
proper, you know, people that aren't here for part of Campfire Convention, because basically this is your Campfire's mission for meaning statement, yeah? So, and everybody needs to go and dance in a circle soon, so we're going to have to wrap it up. So, we are brave, connected and creative as we envision, enable and explore ways to heal ourselves, our communities and our world. I know it's not perfect, I know there's other words we want to put in or take out, but it's a spark of an idea, of a concept, of a mission for meaning statement. I'm disappointed, as P will be, because I do a great thing with a ball of wool and I can't do it, but next time. So thank you for listening and for...
Collaborate. Okay, go again.
I love the colourful clothes she wears, and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of a gentle word on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations, she's giving me excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations, she's giving me excitations.
Good, good, good,
good vibrations. Good, 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 good vibrations. Close my eyes, she's somehow closer now. Softly smile, I know she must be kind. When I look into her eyes, she goes with me to a blossom world. I'm picking up good vibrations, she's giving me excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations, she's giving me excitations.
Good, good, good,
good vibrations.
Good, good, good,
good vibrations. Ah, what a sensation. She takes me there. She's a sensation, sensation. Gotta keep those loving good vibrations happening with us. Gotta keep those loving good vibrations happening with us. Gotta keep those loving good vibrations happening with us. Gotta keep those loving good vibrations happening with us. Gotta keep those loving good vibrations happening with us. Gotta keep those loving good. I don't know where, but she takes me there.